Oke, Mbak Gayatri, silakan dimulai. Mbak Gayatri, suaranya masih mati. Oke.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Untuk saudara Herman,
Waalaikumsalam.
saya lupa tadi tolong siapkan Al-Quran surah Yusuf ayat 6 ya.
Yang mana sih ya?
Surat Yusuf ayat 6. Dibuka
Oh,
surat
Yusuf.
Yusuf ayat 6.
Oke.
Oke, kita bisa mulai, saudara Gostu. Aduh.
Oke. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat malam. Shalom. Kita
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
pada pertemuan kali ini akan pada hari Sabat tanggal 26 November 2022 yang akan kita mulai seperti biasa. Saya akan bacakan ada 12 petugas seperti biasa. Susunan acaranya adalah Gosku memulai pertemuan dan memberitahu tata tertib tentang sema daring ini. Pembukaan sema oleh Mursyid. Tilawah Al-Fatihah. Pendarasan The Beloved and I dalam bahasa Inggris. Pendarasan The Beloved and I dalam bahasa Indonesia. Penutupan sema. Ceramah. Sohbet. Kemudian doa penutup. Tata tertib. Bagi partisipan yang ada di Zoom meeting, mohon mempersiapkan parafernalia, letakkan di dekat Anda, baik itu turbah, sajadah, tasbih, lilin, dan lain-lain. Mohon untuk menutup mic kecuali bagi pendaras atau diminta membuka mic. Silakan menutup kamera jika Anda berkeberatan menayangkan wajah Anda. Bagi partisipasi yang ada di FB Live, mohon mempersiapkan parafernalia, letakkan di dekat Anda, baik itu turbah, sajadah, tasbih, lilin, dan lain-lain. Untuk Sohbet, silakan mengajukan pertanyaan di kolom komentar secara singkat. Ritus pembuka.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Seperti biasa, pada malam hari ini kita akan memulai sema kita dengan membersihkan kotak kita. Kepada Saudara Super Kesi, Saudara Herman, apakah bersedia untuk membersihkan kotak kita pada sema malam ini?
Ya, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Semoga Allah meridai kita malam ini. Semoga empat pir membimbing pikiran dan tindakan kita malam ini dan setelahnya dan selamanya. Amin, amin, amin.
Selanjutnya adalah membersihkan tangan atau berwudu yang akan dibantu oleh saudara Sibiksi, yaitu Mbah Wijanto. Pada Mbah Wijanto, apakah bersedia membantu kita mencuci tangan?
Ya, apakah para peserta bersedia mencuci tangan pertama?
Ya, kita ya. Bersedia.
Apakah para peserta, ya?
Ya,
apakah
ya.
Bersedia yang sama saya menuangkan air untuk mencuci tangan. Allahumma sholli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Adalah kita memasuki ambang pintu yang merupakan lambang dari Nuwun Sewu kepada Imam Ali dan para ahli bait. Saat saya membacakan tawakkul dan syahadat, silakan meletakkan tangan di dada atau mencium rukbah. Syahadat dan tawasul. Aku bersaksi tidak ada Tuhan selain Tuhan dan Muhammad adalah utusannya. Semoga rahmat Allah melimpahi seluruh Nabi, Nabi Adam, Nuh, Ibrahim, Musa, Daud, Yesus, dan Muhammad, dan seluruh pembimbing suci, Imam Ali Murtaza, Al-Hasan, Al-Husain, Ali, Zainal Abidin, Al-Sajjad, Ahmad Al-Bakir, Ja'far Al-Sadiq, Musa Al-Kazim, Ali Arido, Muhammad Al-Taki Al-Jawad, Ali Al-Hadi Al-Naki, Hasan Al-Askari, dan Muhammad Al-Mahdi. Semoga Allah meridhoi haji dan suami. Selanjutnya kita akan menyalakan lilin yang akan dilakukan oleh saudara kita Seraksi. Apakah bersedia menyalakan lilin untuk menerangi sema kita pada malam ini? Saudara Herman?
Ya. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Semoga Allah meridai kita malam ini. Semoga empat pir membimbing pikiran dan tindakan kita malam ini dan setelahnya dan selamanya. Amin, amin, amin.
Amin, ya Rabbal Alamin. Terima kasih. Selanjutnya kita akan mendengarkan pembacaan Al-Furqan atau Dekalog atau 10 perintah Allah yang ada di dalam Keluaran 20 Ulangan 5 dan Al-Baqarah 53 oleh saudara kita Gusti, saudara Agus.
Al-Furqan, The Criterion, Dekalog. 1. Akulah Yahuwahu, Gusti Allahmu. 2. Jangan ada Gusti Allah selain aku. 3. Jangan menyebut nama Yahuwahu, Gusti Allahmu dengan sia-sia. 4. Ingatlah sabat, memeliharanya secara kudus. 5. Hormatilah ayahmu dan ibumu. 6. Jangan membunuh. 7. Jangan berbuat tinaf. 8. Jangan mencuri. 9. Jangan memfitnah. 10. Jangan mengingini kepunyaan orang lain.
Terima kasih. Selanjutnya kita akan memasuki tema. Seperti biasa kita memulai tema kita dengan mendengarkan surah Al-Fatihah dari saudara Mudansi, saudara Herman.
A'udzu billahi minasyaitonir rajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Arrahmanirrahim. Maliki yaumiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdinas siratal mustaqim. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين صدق الله العظيم
صدق الله العظيم. Selanjutnya kita akan memasuki tema mendengarkan dari Zabur, Yubileum dan Al-Qur'an. Pada saudara Yusuf atau Agung, silakan membaca Daniel 7 ayat 5.
Daniel 7 ayat 5. Dan bangkitlah binatang kedua seumpama beruang rupanya, berdiri pada satu sisinya, tiga tulang rusuknya ada di dalam mulutnya, di antara giginya, dan dikatakan kepadanya, lahaplah sebanyak-banyaknya daging sampai akhir zaman tiba.
Selanjutnya adalah pembacaan surah Yusuf ayat 6 oleh saudara Herman. Pada saudara Herman, dipersilahkan.
A'udzubillahi minasyaitonirrajim. Wa kadzalika yajtabika rabbuka yu'allimuka min ta'wilil ahaditsi wa yutimmu ni'matah. وَيُتِمُّ نِعْمَتَهُ عَلَيْكَ وَعَلَى آلِ يَعْقُوبَ كَمَا أَتَمَّهَا عَلَى أَبَوَيْكَ مِنْ قَبْلُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ صدق الله العظيم.
Terima kasih. Selanjutnya adalah Yubileum 4 dibacakan oleh saudara Abi.
Yubilis 46 ayat 1 sampai 2. Arakian setelah berlalu semuanya, Yakub wafat dan Bani Israel jumlahnya di negeri Mesir berkali lipat banyaknya. Jadilah bangsa besar mereka akhirnya dan mereka satu pikiran satu hati, sesama saudara saling mengasihi, setiap orang pun saling memberi dan populasi mereka meningkat. Luar biasa jumlahnya berkali lipat. 10.2242 anno mundi minggu dalam hitungan tahun hari-hari itu. Yubelis ayat 3-4. Demi menghormati Israel, rakyat yang tentram sepanjang hayat, Yusuf di sana. Hatta Yusuf pun wafat dalam usia 10.110. Dalam usia 10.110. 17 tahun hidupnya teguh di negeri Kanaan dan 10 tahun sebagai abdi dalam dan 3 tahun di penjara dan 80 tahun memudar di bawah raja. Memerintah ia di sana Mesir di bawah titahnya. Arakian Yusuf pun meninggal dunia, pun saudara-saudaranya juga dan seluruh generasi itu pula.
Selanjutnya kita akan mendengarkan Wahyu 13. Mbak Dita bisa tolong membacakan Wahyu 13. Halo Mbak Dita, ada di sana?
Sorry, sorry belum dibuka itunya apa?
Tidak apa-apa, kita tunggu.
Lalu
biar Mbak Dita nggak ngantuk.
Oke, lalu kulihat binatang lain tiba keluar dari bumi. Gagah perkasa, bertanduk dua bagai anak domba, bicara bagai naga untuk tipu daya. Segala kuasa pada binatang pertama, lebih parah lagi dijalankan olehnya, menyebabkan seluruh dunia dan segenap penghuninya menyembah si binatang pertama yang telah sembuh luka parahnya. Dan ia mengadakan tanda-tanda luar biasa. Bahkan ke bumi ia turunkan api dalam dari angkasa. Melakukannya di depan mata semua manusia. Menyesatkan yang diam di bumi dengan tanda-tanda yang telah diberikan kepadanya untuk dilakukannya. Di depan mata sang binatang itu, ia menyuruh pula yang diam di bumi agar mereka mendirikan berhala untuk menghormati si binatang yang luka oleh pedang, tapi tetap hidup bersamanya. Lagi, terusin.
Sampai okay. 18.
Kepadanya diberikan kuasa menghidupkan. Citra mempesona binatang itu sedemikian, sehingga citranya akhirnya dapat bicara. Dan bertindak sedemikian rupa sehingga siapapun saja yang tidak menyembahnya sesuai dengan citra itu berhala agar dibunuh. Hatta ia akan sebabkan yang kaya, yang miskin, yang besar juga, yang kecil, yang merdeka juga hamba sahaya untuk menerima tanda pada tangan kanannya atau tanda pada dahinya. Dan tiada seorang pun dapat membeli atau menjual kecuali dengan memiliki tanda atau memiliki nama si binatang atau angka yang diklaim si binatang. Inilah nikmat kebijaksanaannya. Yang memilih pengertian padanya akan tahu jumlah bilangannya pada si binatang. Sebab itu angka seorang manusia inilah angkanya. 666. Jangan sampai tertilam.
Terima kasih, Mbak Rita. Kita sudah
kembali.
Kita sudah memasuki penutupan sema. Selanjutnya, kita akan membacakan. Saya akan membacakan penutupan sema, yaitu dari Enos 93 ayat 7. And after that, in the fifth week at close, the house that they seek of glory and dominion shall be built forever eternal. The fifth age of the world closed with the birth of the Mahdi, whose name fulfilled the word of his grandfather, seer of prophets bold, whose law perfected what had once been told to Enoch when he read the script in gold upon the heavenly tablet in the air.
Daniel 7 ayat 27, Hatta pemerintahan dan kekuasaan dan puncak pemerintahan di bawah kekuasaan, kahyangan yang akan diberikan ke dalam tangan rakyat muhib para wali alionin sekalian, yang hakikat pemerintahnya kekal abadi, dan seluruh kekuasaan akan mengabdi serta menaati segala yang mereka kuasai.
Dan akan ditutup oleh Saudara Herman.
Sebelum ini dalam Zabur telah kami tulis, setelah zikra Taurat menggalaukan, para abdalku yang saleh ialah ahli waris segenap bumi dan dimanapun keberadaan. Surah Al-Anbiya ayat 105, TBAI. Semoga Allah meridhoi sema kita malam ini. Semoga Allah merahmati sohbet kita setelah ini. Semoga empat mursyid membimbing sohbet kita. Dan setelah ini selamanya. Amin, amin, amin.
Amin, ya Rabbal Alamin. Dan karena kita telah berada di penghujung sema, kepada saudara Seraksi, silakan untuk memadamkan lampu. Dan kita akan memasuki sohbet. Tetapi sebelum memasuki sohbet, ada sedikit pengumuman dari saya. Silakan, saudara. Slide selanjutnya. Saya ingin menyampaikan laporan ulunan ya, supaya teman-teman yang menitipkan uang untuk ulunan pada semah pada malam ini mengetahui bahwa ini adalah laporan dari saya. Silahkan di sini. Nanti yang menerima Microsoft PowerPoint ini bisa melihat laporan ini di filenya. Jadi sisanya sekarang kita punya kas untuk sampai tanggal ini adalah 250.000. Terima kasih untuk yang telah turut turunan karena kegiatan ini bisa berjalan terutama untuk Facebook Live dan sewa Zoom. Selanjutnya, set selanjutnya adalah sobat nanti ya, bulan ke-9. Ini juga bisa disimpan di file teman-teman yang mendapatkan PowerPoint ini ya. Selanjutnya ya. Nah, disimpan ya. Kita akan memasuki sohbet pada malam ini, judulnya adalah Ottoman, Usmania. I will try to speak English. Today, as you heard just now, it's from Daniel 7, verse 5, and Revelation 11, Revelation 13, 11 until 16. So, our first point is called the beast that I call as the bear of Mergen. Who is Mergen? Mergen is the god of wealth and wisdom for the Turks. He is the grandson of Tengri. So Tengri is actually the one and only god. Yeah, but I don't know how he has a son in this story. He is also the son of Kaira, the god of creator. So if Tengri is god of god, the heavenly god, Kaira is the god of creator, and he has a son called Mergen. So Mergen always has arrows, and he always rides the white horse, and he was thought that he is very skillful in shooting with the arrow. He's very good in like a sniper, you know. He's very good at a sniper, and he's very powerful. And he lives in the seventh heaven. So not only Islam that have the understanding of the seventh heaven, but also the Tengri, the Turks. Not Tengri, the Turks. So Mergen is also the symbol of brilliant smartness and thought. He is very smart. Interestingly, Ottoman was established by Usman ibn Ertugrul ibn Sulaiman Shah. He was a Ghazi from the tribe of Kayi Oghuz. Actually, his birth name is Turk's name, Atman or Otman. I don't know how to pronounce it in Turkish. But then the name was Arabized, becoming Usman. His father, Ertugrul, was the chief of the tribe of Kayi, And he was known as the best friend and disciple of Syekh Adabali. He is a Sufi Syekh from the Banu Tamim tribe of the family of Al-Katsir. Shortly, Usman fall in love with the Sheikh Adabali's daughter. It is not known whether it is Barahatun or Rabia Barahatun. But because he was not a noble person, but a warrior, a Gazi, Gazi is a warrior. So actually at first, it could not be happened. The historians dispute whether Malahatun as the daughter of Adabali or a daughter of a duke in Anatolia who makes an alliance with Usman in the politics and military. What is certain, both of the wives, Usman has two sons, Orhan ibn Malah and Alauddin ibn Rabia. So Orhan and Alauddin. This is different from all the Ottoman kings after them. Orhan and Alauddin, they were collaborating by establishing the Imperium of Ottoman. They did not do the patricide or killing each other for the throne. However, after that, the tradition of patricide is common from the kings of the Ottomans and only ended during the Sultan Ahmed I. Do you remember the famous concert? Qasem, you know the movie Qasem. He was very famous because he held the power behind the curtain and become the regent for Sultan. So this is Qasem, the consort of Ahmed I. As you can see, the determination of Osman when he wanted to marry the daughter of Sheikh Adabali has made him become the disciple of Adabali. And Adabali was a very responsible Sheikh Sufi. What I understand from the story that he was responsible with the policies of politics and military of In other words, the Derja of or the Tekke or the Zawiya of Adabali has a role in the birth of this bear called Merjan. Just now you heard from Daniel 7, ya, tadi mendengar Daniel 7, the bear is Ottoman. Or if we want to understand in different way, in different perspective, actually Usman was using his relationship with his teachers, with his mushrik, and his father-in-law to strengthen his legitimation of his power. Now, Usman was born a few years after Bektaswali was dead. Bektaswali left his son to New Delhi in a very harsh Gazi world. It was the age of warlords in Anatolia. It's like a cowboy world, everybody fighting each other. Now, soon after Osman became a very powerful Gazi, his Sultanate conquered almost all Byzantine into his power. And we know that this place, Anatolia, was a Christian world, the Orthodox Christianity. So if you remember Qasem and Hürrem, everybody remember the movie Hürrem and Qasem. They were both very powerful women in Ottoman, and they come from the background of Orthodox Christianity. They were slave girl and become a slave in the harem, and soon they become the favorite concubine, and soon they become a very powerful consort or sultana. Yeah. So Qasem from Phoenicia and Hürrem from Ukraine. Now you can get the picture how Ottoman was established. Kita sekarang dapat gambaran bagaimana Ottoman itu terbentuk dengan latar belakang sejarah yang seperti ini. The ability of Usman using the legitimation made him make him legitimate, or we can say that this is why in the text of Revelation it was called he has two horns like the onion, like the lamb, because he was so powerful, he was so legitimate with the sufi, with the sidra, everything, you know. And also from the word two horns, we can understand that it means Ottoman conquered two important regions, Europe and Asia. Now, Turk, Mongol, like August, under the banner of Ottoman, and then Timuran, they went all to India, to Mughal, and everyone from the Turks and Mongols, they conquered Europe and Asia. This is why we heard from Revelation 13 just now. It is like the lamb. And they have crown like the Sufi, like sacred, and using wars and politics to conquer all Europe and Asia. The next thing is, we heard that in the text of Revelation, the bear or the beast is also talked about the dragon. Who is the dragon? The dragon was in Damascus, was Umayyad. How this is happened? We shall see it since Ertugrul and his very close relationship with Sheikh Adabali. In the text of Revelation, the bear or Mergen come out from the earth. Why? Because this old Ertugrul and Gulus Arp was from Kayi. Kayi is a sub-tribe of Oghuz who has migrated and lived in Anatolia. However, historians dispute whether Gulus Arp was the uncle or the grandfather of Usman. Anyway, both of them, Ertugrul and Gulus Arp, if you remember the movie Ertugrul, there is a Turkish movie about Ertugrul, ada film tentang Ertugrul serial itu ya. Both are very famous warriors of Gazi. The chief of Gazi. This is how Ottoman become a very powerful imperial. And Oghuz was actually originated from the Altai, Mongol. So they are not Arab. They are not even Persian. But Ottoman was Persianized. They have the ethos, they have the culture like Persian. So they were actually following or continuing the steps of Abbasid. Two times or 360 years after the death of Imam Hasan al-Askari, if you remember Revelation 12 verses 14. So we add 874 plus 360 is 1,234 Common Era. That year was the time when Bhaji Bekaswari got enlightenment. He realized after he became a Ghazi. So Haji Bekaswari was also a Ghazi. And then suddenly he was a Ghazi of the Seljuk. Jadi Haji Bekaswari itu ada Ghazi yang direkrut oleh Seljuk. And during a war, he saw his brother Mintaj was killed. This is the starting point when Haji Bekaswari started to realize something. And he went to a small village and he met Hoja Idris. Dia bertemu dengan seorang sesepuh bernama Hoja Idris. Since then, he did what his great grandfather Prophet Muhammad did. He went to meditation, and after that, he went to preach about the teachings of his grandfather, Prophet Muhammad. Haji Bekaswari was the descendant of Imam Musa Al-Kazim. If we count from 1201 to 40 years is 1249 Common Era. So when Haji Bekaswari was 40 years old, it is around 1249 Common Era. What happened during that time, during the 13th century, this is very interesting. So since to 1250s, there has been a very famous eruption in Samaras and Rinjani in our region, Lombok, Nusa Tenggara Barat, or the West Timor. So it is not far from Kupang where Agung Nawelit, nggak jauh dari tempat Agung, itu ada Gunung Samaras dan Gunung Rinjani. Suddenly it erupted in 1257. The VEI scale is 6. It's very large, very big. Yeah. This eruption makes change in the climate. So several times it makes a very long winter. And because of this long winter, Europe has to experience a very great trouble in the agriculture. Therefore, they experience the great starvation. And then they also experience, later, they experience the bubonic plague, wabah, pandemi bubonic, in the 14th century. If you remember the story of Hans and Gretel, this is actually the story from the era. That is because what? Because eruption in our region. Jadi, kisah Hans dan Gretel itu ternyata berhubungan dengan gunung berapi meledak di negara kita, gitu kan. Also, during at that time, Usman was born as the son of Ertugrul. Maybe around 1254 or 1255. And then around 1280s, he become a bey or duke, adipati. In the Bithynia. Bithynia is a very strategic place in the town of Sogut, in the Sultanate of Seljuk. So his career had been reached high in 1289. At the same time, Tripoli in Libya was conquered by the Mamluk in April from the Crusaders. So this is during the Crusade War. Yeah. So he has the spirit that he also defeated the Byzantine troops and then took over their strategic cities since 1301 Common Era, and then he built the city Yeniseyev as the capital of Ottoman in 1302. Now let's go back to the story of Haji Becakwali. 18 years after 1234, Safiuddin Ardabili was born. Who is he? He was a very famous Sufi who established the Safavid Tariqah. What this Tariqah is very famous because from the Tariqah, there comes the famous Shah Ismail. Shah Ismail was the one who built the Safavid. Yeah. Safavid is the competitor of Ottoman. Safavid ini saingannya Ottoman. And although Safavid was Hanafi in fiqh, but actually it was Shia. And because of Safavid, Iran today become Shia. You know, before that, Iran was not Shia, was not Twelver. They were Hanafi. And then after Safavid, they become Twelver. Yeah. So I want you to know all this background during when Ottoman was rise. Jadi kita melihat bagaimana saat Ottoman itu tumbuh, latar belakang dari sejarah yang mengelilingi tumbuhnya si beruang merdan ini. Now I want to tell something about why I say about the eruption in Lombok. Ya, kenapa kita membahas mengenai gunung berapi yang meledak di Lombok? We are all human beings live in one ark, and our earth is the ark. And our earth and our cosmos is our challenger. In the story of Noah, truth is a sign about our greatest challenge as human beings. That is the disaster and all the implications. This is the wisdom of the story of Flood or story of Noah. Now we can see the relationship with the eruption of a mount in our region, Nusantara, and the coming of drought season and winter in other places. So this is like when we lost a butterfly in Amazon city, then we have climate change problems in our world today. Jadi, this is what we call as Tauhid, as unity. We see all the reality in our world as one unity of reality. Now let's go back to the story of Ottoman and relationship with Haji Becakwali. If we all remember Revelation 2, first draft until 17, which is specifically for the congregation or the abdas and murid in Pergamum, it is also prophecies to what will happen to Anatolia during Ottoman was born to conquer them. In that revelation, we heard that the throne of Iblis is not just during the Hellenic time when it adopted Christianity or it makes and created Christianity. It was happened during the Constantine the Great after he was baptized by an Arian. Pergamum was also conquered for some time by the Sasan in 620 by the Umayyad. In 715 by the Umayyad, before that 620 during Rasulullah, and then Umayyad 715, and then by the Rum Sultanate 1074 until 1797. So this area, Pergamum, was always being the subject of people to be conquered. And then taken back by the Eastern Byzantine. And all the places that are strategic in Anatolia become the places of everybody want to get that place. The Ghazi, the Byzantine, the Christian, everybody. This is why I call it as the age of the warlord. Yeah, cowboy try to get the territory there. The Rum, the Sultanate of Rum, was established by Sulaiman ibn Qutulmis, a distant cousin of Sultan Malik Shah ibn Abd Arslan from the Seljuk Sultanate. Abd Arslan or Muhammad ibn Daud Shaghi ibn Mikail ibn Seljuk was the second Seljuk Sultanate. And his famous prime minister was Nizam al-Muluk. Daud Shaghi and his brother Tughril was the founder of Seljuk. So this is the background of Ottoman. Before Ottoman, we have Seljuk. So before Ottoman, Seljuk and then Rum tried to conquer Anatolia, but it was Ottoman who was succeeded to do so. Ya, jadi yang berhasil melakukan itu adalah Ottoman, walaupun Seljuk dan Rum telah memulainya. Therefore, Pergamum is one of the city that witnessed the heart of the Crusade War that was happened since the 11th century. So we remember that two times or 360 years after the death of Imam Ja'far as-Sadiq was 1060 Common Era. And this was during the Caliph Al-Qa'im from the Abbasid dynasty. He married Arslan Akhatun Khoja. So she was the daughter of this Daud Shaghi. So in other words, Abd Arslan was the brother-in-law of Akhatun. What happened after that? 40-60 years after that, all the kings of Europe was motivated by the priests, the Catholic priest in Rome, to start the Crusade War. Yeah, they wanted to take back the power of Islam. They called the troops of Islam as Saracen. They want to take back Jerusalem from them. This is what happened in 1096. The first Crusade War happened. But remember, during that time, Islam was actually still seen as a apostasy of Jews, yeah, or the wrong Christian. It's not seen as different religion. It's like another branch of Jews or another branch of Christianity. Because Islam did not hold a faith about the right Jesus according to the church at that time. At after the Concil of Nicaea in the 4th century. Yeah. That was what happened still during the Abbasid. And later, after the eruption in Lombok, ya, setelah erupsi terjadi di Lombok, ya kan, the Abbasid was wounded. You heard the story, you heard in Revelation 13, the bear wound, the beast was wounded. Ada binatang yang terluka parah, ya kan, tadi kita dengar itu. So after passing that, the caliphate of Islam was divided into so many kingdoms of Islam, so many sultanates. And then afterwards, Baghdad was defeated by the Mongol. You know, you remember in Indonesian world, we call they were so bengis, they were so evil, so wicked, so cruel. The word bengis, kata bengis in Malay language, was actually came from the name Genghis Khan. I want to tell you that one of the key of the success of this Mongol trip is actually because they come so early to the Baghdad city. Everybody in the Abbasid place palace thought that they will come very late. But they come very fast. How? Because they can manage to do something with their food. So they can have a food in tin. Jadi mereka mengawetkan makanan mereka. Jadi mereka bisa makan sambil jalan, nggak perlu menunggu berlama-lama cari sumber pangan dan berlama-lama berdiam. So this is the key factor of their success. One of them. That they come so fast that the Abbasid were not yet prepared by their coming. After that, in 1261, Al-Muntazir ran away to Egypt. He was actually succeeded to establish the second Abbasid in Cairo. But it was actually under the Mamluk. Mamluk is a term for slaves that become paid gazi in a kingdom or for a crown or for a imperial. However, Al-Muntazir was killed in a war, and then that's why Abbasid, the second Abbasid, fell into Al-Hakim. So actually Al-Hakim was the fifth or the sixth generation from Al-Mustaqim. Jadi ini keturunan yang jauh-jauh banget gitu. Kayak saya gitu tiba-tiba mengklaim karena saya keturunan yang Mangkunegara III, saya mendirikan kerajaan Mangkunegara baru gitu, seperti itu mungkin ya. Jadi so this is the story of Mamluk which still claim the caliphate at that time. Yeah. In 1517 Common Era, the Abbasid in Cairo was named Al-Mutawakkil III. He gave the sword and the robe of Prophet Muhammad as a symbol of legitimation of the Islamic power to Selim the First, yeah, Selim the First of Ottoman. This is the symbol that shows to us the caliph is now in the hands of Ottoman. So, since then, the caliphate was no longer in the hands of the Quraysh, but in the hands of the Turks. Ya, jadi sejak itu bukan lagi orang Quraysh yang memimpin caliphate Islam, tapi orang Turki, orang Turk. Ya. Now, the Quraysh of the Umayyah who give birth to the dragon has gone. Also, the Quraysh who give birth to the leopard beast has no longer lived. Now we have the bear of Mersin who was born by the August Turk. The bear of Mersin, however, even though they were Turk, they as we can hear just now in the Revelation 13, they glorified the legacy of Umayyad in the Arabization of the teachings of Muhammad, and how the Abaddon distinct itself from the Jewish and Christianity. How Abaddon or Al-Hajjaj and Abdul Malik created a new religion separated from the root or the father and mother of the Bani Israel. Moreover, the bear also glorified the legacy of Abbasid in religion, especially in hadith and etc. And then during this time, the Ottoman said, the door of Istihad now closed. This is perfectly said or prophesied in the 12th, the first draft of Revelation. Jadi persis terjadi digenapi oleh Ottoman. What more surprising or upsetting is this bear of Mersin. He was successful in controlling hundreds or even thousands of Sufi tariqa. All the networks, all the factions. So that all Sufis now support Ottoman in Anatolia and all places around in Europe, especially Southern Europe, ya, terutama sebelah tenggara Eropa. For example, Naqshbandi and Maulawi that has a very fortunate existence because of their Sunni, because Sunni is a major, they have a benefit from this. But also, remember, this Ottoman also control all the Shia of Ali until they all become united in the pattern of Haji Bektaswali. So Haji Bektaswali's abdals and murid also being controlled by Ottoman. Jadi jangan salah, Bektaswali juga dikontrol oleh Ottoman. Ini ada kalau bisa mendengarkan dari siapa Ismail Fadil Al-Atas, itu ada di YouTube-nya dia tentang ini ya, tentang bagaimana sejarah sufi-sufi itu dikendalikan oleh Ottoman. What happened? Recording stop? Oh, kayaknya tiba-tiba hilang ya? Oh, sebentar. Maaf. Saya share ya dari saya ya. Kayaknya Agung lagi bermasalah itunya. Oke. Okay. Tadi kita sampai mana ya? Mati lampu kayaknya Agung.
Aswali kalau nggak salah.
Ya, enggak ya. Belum kelihatan ya gambarnya ya? Ini udah ya?
Yang ini udah.
Ya, bentar. Ininya loadingnya lama. Kupang sedang mati lampu. Kupang. Bagaimana, Saudara Agung? Kembali. Saya tekel dulu, Agung. Bentar. Ya, ini sudah ya. Oke. Oh, yang ini belum ya. Ini belum ya. So, as
halaman
I just now.
Halaman 54 kayaknya tadi.
Ya, ini. Ya, this one. So, I want to continue just now because our operator has a problem in this phrase. I will continue about how Ottoman conquered and control all Sufi tarekat. Ya. So, not just the Sunni, but also the Shia, or especially the Bektashi. Actually, all Shia Sufis now is controlled and under one united patron called Haji Bektashi. Jadi seluruh yang Shia Ali itu sekarang dipersatukan, yang Sufi-Sufinya ya, tapi bukan yang bukannya ini yang non-Sufi ya. Yang Sufi Shia itu dipersatukan dalam sosok Bektashi. So now all hundreds of Dajjal who accept the authority of Imam Ali in all level and in various cities, not just Ja'fari, because many of them also like doing the fiqh of Hanafi. And because of them were famous as rebellion, because of them are famous as rebellion and famous of trying to against the power. They threaten the power of Ottoman. They are so many in until Hungary, until Russia, you know. And actually, they have different kinds of Wali that they venerated. But now, under the Ottoman, everybody is united under the Star Wali. The Turks, which among them also the Oghuz people, some of them also accept the authority of Imam Ali. For example, the Kizilbash. So the Kizilbash as the origination of Alevi, yeah. So that is the story of Bektashi people, those who accept the authority of Haji Bektashi during the Ottoman. And that is exactly what happened during Balin Sultan. Balin Sultan, dead in 1517, was a Bektashi Derja, actually responsible for establishing what we call today as the Babakar. Yeah. So it has a system like the Greek Orthodox churches, their neighbor. because they he plays the role of the priest of this this Orthodox. Jadi karena orang-orang itu memeluk Islam, terus mereka pilih tradisi Bektasi. Jadi fungsi dan peran para pendeta Ortodoks Yunani itu dialihkan, digantikan oleh para baba. Jadi para baba ini mirip dengan para pendeta Ortodoks Yunani. Now they are centered in Albania and Macedonia. And they actually supported a lot of Ottoman policies. I don't know whether they did that because of Takia or not. Yeah. Especially because they involved in the famous Janissary. You know, the famous Janissary, they kidnap Christian children and do Islamization in Balkan. And Bayung Sultan was operating with Bayazid II. His father was Musa Baba, and his mother was a peasant. So as you can see in the Revelation textures, the word signs can be also understood as using the sacred text for the interest of power, for abusing it to control and manage the imperialism of Ottoman. It happens after Abbasid produced the fiqh on jurisprudence. And Abbasid has successfully fabricated thousands of hadiths as a new authority in Islam. After that, now Islam has a similar worldview or perspective like in Christianity. Now we have the understanding of this is the right faith about Muhammad as the standard of criterion. Before that we don't have. Jadi sebelum ini kita nggak punya satu ketetapan bahwa iman yang benar tentang Muhammad itu harus ini. Enggak, sebelumnya nggak ada seperti itu. Tapi setelah Ottoman, setelah Abbasiyah, setelah Ottoman terutama kita punya kriteria iman yang benar tentang Muhammad itu apa. So now we have a new criterion of faith. The what is right about Muhammad, and that happened because of so many hadiths and so many fiqhs that was solidified and become so established during the Abbasid. Ya. Jadi ini Ottoman ini tinggal bikin berhalanya aja gitu, dia sudah membangun gitu. Now we can see how the legacy of the dragon and the legacy of the leopard, ya, the dragon is Umayyad, the leopard is Abbasid, has widespread and inflicted all mass-up of Islam, Sunni, Shia, Ibadi, even especially Wahhabi today. Even the Sufis, even the Bektashi too. Although we can have a good assumption to Sheikh Adebari, who already educated Uthman, or we have a good assumption to Bayung Sultan, when he cooperated with Bayazid II, that they actually have to do so to survive under this warlord, yeah, and the criminal wars, yeah. However, this is what happened during at that time. So, from Revelation 2, verse 12 and 17, we have five points. First is Said the Taswai was in the place of the throne of Iblis. Yeah. He was born there as Santo Antipas, Saint Antipas, who was killed by the Nero. So Saint Antipas was very royal to the teaching of Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ was the one who guided Prophet Muhammad and Imam Ali and then Imam Mahdi also. So now he also guided Said bin Taswai in the throne of Iblis. Jadi saatnya sekarang pada masa sebelum Ottoman muncul, before the come. So this is the time before the rise of Ottoman. Jesus come back to guide us and he chose Said bin Taswai. Yeah. The next is, according to the Revelation 12, verse 14, the disciples of Said bin Taswai live among the Muslims and Christians that recognize the religion that against the Decalogue or Apocryphon. So we can see during those years, the Muslims and the Christians have started giving sacrifice to the idol. What is the idol? The idol is the religion of Islam and the religion of Christianity. This is how in Revelation 13, verse 14, we can see from Ottoman there the famous ideology of Pan-Islamism or Khilafah. Yeah. This is what in the Bilaf and I said they were doing adultery. Metaphorically, yeah. Because they betrayed, they violated their akad, their alliance that they accept from the Prophet Muhammad and from Jesus Christ by using the worldview of Chinese faith of Hellenism, Persia, and Mesopotamia. Jadi dalam the Bill of Rights, makanya disebutkan bahwa mereka ini melakukan perzinahan, final, ya. Sinaf itu apa? Sinaf sebenarnya kata yang tepat itu sinaf. Sinaf itu apa? Sinaf itu adalah melanggar perjanjian pernikahan. Kan? Nah, di sini dijadikan metafora bahwa kita sebagai murid atau abdal kita sudah menerima sanad dari Muhammad dan Yesus, jadi kita seharusnya tidak melanggar akad kita dengan mereka, dengan menjadi iman kain, ya kan? Nah, yang ketiga, the third is, you remember, you see just now we have the schema, we always have to turn light off the candles, yeah. So in Revelation 12, verse 15, the disciples of Said bin Taswai, during the Sema, they always slandered by others, Muslim especially. They were doing orgy, ya. Orgy itu apa ya? Sex bersama-sama gitu kan. Doing together the sex. Yeah. This is a very harsh slander, ya. Ini fitnah yang kejam, ya kan. Jadi, actually this slanders came from their memory when they talk and they remember about the Nicolaitan, yeah, yeah. Everybody remember that Nicolaitan was a sect who did mischievous sex conduct. Now, actually this all the they said people said were done by secret circles. The word secret circles called Freemason. Jadi kata Freemason itu sebetulnya artinya lingkaran-lingkaran rahasia, yang pokoknya organisasi rahasia itu namanya Freemason. That they claim as to create rights and paid and supported Ottoman. Yeah. So this is a slander to Bektashi, slander to Alevi, but actually there are those secret circles that also claim like that and do all this, but not the Bektashi. Fourth is from Revelation 12, verse 12, Revelation 12, verse 16. The disciples of Said Bektashi, until today, they were the symbol of Zulfikar, the sword of Zulfikar. This is to remember the symbol of the word of God.
Suara hilang, Mbak.
Oh ya, sorry. Sorry. So, the Zulfikar sword was a symbol of the word of God. Every time there is an apostasy among the children of Israel, we can see that the guidance from the prophet and the leader or guide, Enoch, Elijah, Jesus, and Muhammad, Mahdi, always return to us. This is what happened because of the methodology of the Tree of Life. Jadi seperti metodologi yang kita sampaikan itu pohon hayat. Walaupun ada kesesatan, tetap karena masih ada pohon hayat, maka kita bisa mengenali kembali firman Allah, walaupun ada hal-hal seperti yang saya ceritakan tadi, yaitu Ottoman, kemudian Safawiyah, dan seterusnya. So, Bektashi was an example from the 13th century. Just a few years before the Ottomans, how we can keep the decalogue to survive and to protect ourselves during this life of this giant. Yeah, Ottoman is a giant. And last but not least, the fifth from the Revelation 12, verse 17, the disciple of the Bektashi, until today, we have the symbol of the white stone. Actually, not really white, yeah. This is like what I wear today. What I wear today, not really white, this is green. So this is about the mujizat, the miracle of mana. Mana is actually a blessing about this transmission. So this is also a proof that we continuously keeping our sanat, our silsila from Moses, Jesus, and Imam Ali. So this, I give you some examples of stories. Maybe not so important, but I will just skip. I will give this to you just for information. Jadi ini hanya tambahan dari saya tentang pegang. About this is just historical information about how important Pergamum as a place where there was a famous story of Asclepius and Therophorus, and we have the relationship parallel with the story of Nehushtan, the bronze serpent. Every story about this is actually story about shamanism, about healing, about medication. Yeah. Jadi ini semua cerita tentang yang berhubungan dengan pengobatan, shamanisme, yang saling terkait. I want to share this to you because I want us to contemplate how important actually religion or spirituality in our life actually is. What? It's what for? It's for healing. It's for rectification. So this is also like not far from Anatolia, there is an island called Pharmakonisi. Hippocrates often came to that island, and we have the famous oath of doctors from the oath of Hippocrates. Yeah. So in Anatolia also, the Bektashis was famous for having the aroma. Karoma ini, the ability to cure, yeah. Famous in LLB women, they are famous by using just their hands to heal. Jadi dukun di sana juga mengenal dukun-dukun gitu. Ini menarik. Jadi ini saya ingin menyampaikan ini untuk memberi pemahaman kepada kita bagaimana kita itu terhubung bukan hanya di Nusantara tapi juga di Anatolia tentang adanya orang-orang yang bisa menyembuhkan dan dianggap punya karoma, kesaktian, dan lain sebagainya. All about this is actually a code. Whether or not this is real healing or not, this is a code about the practice of shamanism by the Tarika of Al-Islam. So either I can really heal you or not, this is not important. But the important is that religion and spirituality of the Tariqah of Islam is to heal and to do rectification. So actually in Pergamum there was this throne of Zeus. This throne of Zeus is what John in Patmos said, the throne of Iblis. Now it was moved to the Museum of Pergamum in Berlin. So the real throne of Iblis was existed, ya. Ada benar namanya tahta Iblis itu sebetulnya tahtanya Zeus itu di altar Zeus itu ada. Dia ada di Museum Pergamum. Nah, so this is the first point. Jadi malam ini cuma ada 2 poin. Mungkin sebelum yang poin yang kedua kita bisa diskusi, ya. Halo? Ada yang mau bertanya?
Malam, Mbak.
Malam, Mas Adi. Apa kabar?
Baik, Mbak. Aku mau nanya yang dekalog. Kan ada poin terakhir, jangan mengingini kepunyaan orang lain. Definisinya gimana ya, Mbak?
Oh, oke.
Okay. Kalau pengen kan pasti manusiawi, ya. Ah, pengen kayak gitu, pengen kayak gitu. Ya. Yang seperti apa yang nggak boleh nih, Mbak?
Oh, oke. Okay. Baik. Jadi memang saya sering sekali menuliskan bahwa jangan punya orang lain itu adalah perintah yang paling sulit. Sepertinya itu yang paling sulit dan itu yang paling sering dilanggar. Ketika itu dilanggar maka semua hal dilanggar. Jadi menginginkan punya orang lain itu sederhananya ada serakah. Serakah, sederhananya kata-kata. Kita sudah punya baju misalnya, baju bagus, terus kita melihat orang lain punya baju juga yang lebih bagus. Dan kita begitu menginginkan sampai kita mungkin akan mencuri baju itu. Atau kita akan melakukan kejahatan yang melanggar sila-sila yang lain seperti misalnya memfitnah atau misalnya menyakiti istri kita atau suami kita sampai kita punya baju itu kan serakah. Jadi kata pendek kata itu sebetulnya itu serakah. Jangan menginginkan orang itu sebenarnya serakah itu aja.
Soalnya kan sekarang kita hidup di zaman semuanya iklan, Mbak.
Ya, dan, itu kan tidak,
kebetulan
tidak
kan enggak
orang lain. Itu kita men,
ya, karena, bukan ya berarti ya.
Bukan.
Kepengen enggak. Aja ya. Kepengen ya. Kepengen aja enggak apa-apa asal jangan kelebihan gitu mungkin we.
Iya, iya, iya.
Ya. Kita boleh. Terima kasih, Mbak.
Jadi kalau orang berdagang tentu beda dengan menginginkan orang lain. Nah, ini sama ya sebetulnya sama dengan kenapa imperialisme, kekaisaran itu tidak boleh. Kenapa kita tidak boleh misalnya melakukan islamisasi atau kristenisasi. Karena itu kan kita seperti ingin mengambil umat orang lain. Atau kita ingin supaya misalnya semua orang di Jawa itu masuk agama kita. Misalnya apa yang saya sampaikan di sini, saya kan orang yang sudah tahu tentang Al-Quran, sudah tahu tentang Alkitab. Kalau dia nggak pernah tahu Alkitab dan Al-Quran, bukan maksud saya itu, bukan saya cuma menyampaikan versi saya aja gitu. Bedanya seperti itu, saya cuma bedanya dengan yang healing adalah kita sudah tahu, kita sudah dari kecil kita sudah diajar Islam atau dari kecil kita diajar Kristen gitu kan. Nah sekarang karena agama Islam dan agama Kristen itu sudah sedemikian sering membuat kita trauma gitu kan. Nah, bagaimana healingnya gitu. Beda juga kalau kita datang ke orang-orang, misalnya orang-orang ini ya, orang-orang Badui gitu kan, sebelum mereka masuk Islam. Itu termasuk pelanggaran kepada sila yang ke-10 itu tadi.
Oh, iya. Iya. Ternyata kelihatannya sederhana tapi enggak sederhana, iya. Siap. Terima kasih, Mbak.
Iya, sama-sama. Ya, selanjutnya.
Malam Mbak Gayatri.
Malam, itu siapa?
Wahyuni.
Oh, Mbak Wahyuni, ya.
Ya, mau bertanya yang mengenai paparan tadi. Itu Fatimiyah ada di mana ya? Di rangkaian itu perannya. Kemudian kan di apa namanya zaman Fatimiyah itu apa dikenal dengan adanya assassin gitu ya? Mbak Gayatri. Nah sebenarnya mereka melakukan itu apa karena untuk melindungi lingkaran mereka atau apa ya? Terima kasih.
Terima kasih Mbak Wayuni. Ya, Fatimiyah ada di Mesir dan itu sebelum kejadiannya adalah sebelum Salahuddin Al-Ayyubi. Berarti itu sebelum perang Fatih pertama ya. Jadi sebelum Ottoman berdiri. Dan Fatimiyah ini apa ya? Jadi mereka berusaha menyintas dengan juga mendirikan kerajaan. Sama seperti yang terjadi di Perak. Perak itu kan juga dinasti Syiah sebetulnya. Dan saya berpikir bahwa itu dinasti Syiah yang masih meyakini bahwa Muhammad ibn Ali Ahanafiyah gitu. Karena itulah cerita-cerita tentang ibn Ali Ahanafiyah itu begitu populer sebenarnya di Aceh daripada apa yang Ismailiyah dan yang kemudian adalah Umayyah yang sekarang. Jadi itu cara melintas pada masa itu. Dan siapakah asasin ini? Saya pikir kalau ada sesuatu yang buruk mengenai Syiah, Syiah Ali maksudnya, yang menerima, maksudnya di sini bukan Syiah yang dalam pemikiran saat ini ya, Syiah Ali di sini saya maksudnya menerima dan mengakui otoritas Imam Ali dalam sama sebagai yang diberi ijazah untuk mentasbihkan. Jadi yang saya maksud itu ya Syiah Ali. Jadi Syiah Ali ini kalau kita lihat di satu kronologi dia dianggap sesuatu yang buruk, kita perlu bertanya apakah ini adalah itu bentuk propaganda atau bentuk untuk merendahkan otoritas dari Imam Ali itu sendiri dengan menjelekkan umatnya, menjelekkan pengikutnya. Karena pola ini terjadi di semua agama, di semua kelompok. Katakanlah tidak usah ya agama, katakanlah gini, kita ingin menjelek-jelekkan ajarannya Marxis, ya kan? Sebetulnya kalau kita melihat ajaran Marxis itu kan ada satu cita-cita idea yang indah, yang tidak salah-salah amat kan kita ingin hidup bersama, berbagi kepemilikan yang tidak buruk kan? Dan itu satu upaya ikhtihad dari Karl Marx melihat adanya permasalahan di negaranya dia saat itu, di Jerman saat itu kan. Tetapi kemudian untuk menjelekkan ajaran Karl Marx, kita kan akan mengatakan, oh komunis itu, orang komunis itu jahat. Itu lihat itu yang di Korea Utara, Kim Jong Il gitu kan. Atau kita lihat TKI begini-begini. Yang dijelekkan kan adalah orang-orangnya, fenomenanya. Tanpa kita mau melihat seperti apa ajaran Marxis. Tanpa kita mau melihat seperti apa sih sebetulnya yang disampaikan oleh Karl Marx. Itu saja di dalam dunia sekuler. Apalagi kalau dalam dunia agama. Kalau tidak digerak-gerakkan umat yang mengenai kekerasan, ya kan, seperti hasil itu. Yang kedua adalah pasti difitnah secara skandal seks. Seperti yang tadi saya sampaikan, difitnahlah orang-orang Alewi itu melakukan orgi setelah memadamkan lampu tadi. Jadi kita itu, makanya kita kan mengadakannya Facebook Live. Jadi, oh, sudah bukan rahasia lagi. Habis pada mampu, kita kan nggak melakukan orgi, kan? Habis pada mampu, kita kan sobet, gitu kan? Nah, fitnahnya itu tahu dua. Kalau nggak melakukan kekerasan yang seperti asasin itu, yang kedua ada seks. Coba lihat, banyak orang, banyak aktivis, banyak pejuang juga jatuh karena fitnah skandal seks. Tapi itu juga bisa jadi gini. Bisa jadi benar juga, ya. Bisa jadi begitu juga. Tapi sebenarnya ini pola yang dua itu yang bisa saya temukan. Kalau ada pola-pola yang lain bisa di-share ke saya ya, yang saya lupa, mungkin saya lupa gitu, ada mungkin pola-pola lain. Begitu Mbak Wahyuni, terima kasih.
Ya, terima kasih Mbak.
Oke, apakah Agung bisa share itu lagi, Agung?
Bisa.
Ganti dirimu ya, ini aku stop share ya.
Oke, siap.
Mungkin ada pertanyaan lagi sebelum kita lanjut yang lain? Kalau nggak ada, kita lanjut ke poin kedua ya. Poin kedua. So, the second point is the monster 666. This is a very very famous number, yeah. Everybody afraid of number 666. Now, let's go as we are a tourist. Mari kita membayangkan diri kita sebagai turis pada malam ini. We will go to the city called Assos. Assos is a city near Pergamo and it is near the seaside of Marmara. When we see Assos, we remember Aristotle. Everybody know who is Aristotle. We also remember Usman, who was the disciple of Sheikh Al-Jabari, and he was the one who established Ottoman that was so powerful. As the text Revelation 13, verse 15, Ottoman during Usman was not yet establishing the idol to be worshipped. This happened during Bayezid II. After we left the Academy of Platon in Athena, after leaving the Academy of Platon in Athena, Aristotle opened his academy in Athos. At the time, it was led by the King Hermias. Aristotle then married his adopted daughter, Pythias, and he developed the science in Assos, especially in zoology and biology. However, Persia later attacked Assos, killed Hermias, and Aristotle ran away to Macedonia, and Macedonia was ruled by his friend Philip II. And then later, Aristotle became the mentor of Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great was the person who conquered so many countries under the Imperium of Greece. In Daniel 7, the leopard is actually the Greek. So, not the leopard, the bear. And the Malay word, the Malay word also worship or glorify Alexander the Great. For example, sejarah Melayu. So if you remember sejarah Melayu, it claims that the kings of Malay came from Alexander the Great. Jadi kalau baca sejarah Melayu itu ada klaim raja-raja Melayu itu keturunan Iskandar Agung. Why? Because this is related with Ottoman. Kenapa? Karena ini berkaitan dengan Ottoman. Revelation 13 verse 13 to 17 depicts how Islam was developed and later established by Abbasid. Seljuk and Ottoman was the dynasty as well as just now under Abbasid. They were all Persianized Turks. They were Turks, but their speech and their culture were also Persian. So that was why, yeah, during Ottoman, the language of the elite is Persian. Not Turk. It's not Arab, but Persian. Ottoman did Islamization that was so massive in Europe. They kidnapped children of Christians and brainwashed them and trained them to become the troops of Janissaries. Yeah. Bayezid II was born in Dinepoka and was a friend of Bayim Sultan. His mother, Aminah Gulbahar Hatun, was a convert of Albania, as well as his wife, Aisha Gulbahar Hatun. Bayezid II's father was Al-Fatih, the famous Al-Fatih. Or Mehmed II. He was the one who changed Hagia Sophia in Constantinople, become the mosque. And Bayezid II also have a very romantic relationship with the Prince of Radi, Radi the beautiful prince. So this is homosexual atau all homo romantic relationship between two of them, ya. Jadi ini hubungan yang aneh, apa? Homo romantic, ya. Entah homoseksual tapi pasti homo romantic. Now, during this time, Bayezid II have so many challenges from the Safavid, especially the Kizilbash. The Kizilbash or the founder of Alevi often do rebellion. And they were supported by Shah Ismail. Yeah. This letter happened during the time of Selim the First. Selim the First was the one who makes all Abbasid, the remains of Abbasid, now they accept the legitimation of Salim as the caliphate of Islam. So since Salim the First, we have Ottoman as the caliphate of Islam. Yeah, jadi sejak zaman Salim. Whatever happens during 1517, during Salim, has already prophesied by this verses Revelation 13. Including the ideology of panislamism or khilafah, dari buta rir ideology, the neo Ottomanism. This is like a virus that is very difficult to tackle, always mutated and always trying to destroy and always trying to make how you call it very aggressive. Then weaker, yeah. We can feel today how we are traumatized as Muslims when we have to deal with this idea of pan-Islamism, Islamic politics, etc., etc. Yeah. The next is, after Salim the First, this is the time when the idol was fully erected by the Ottoman, by the monster 666, which was on the throne of the Bear of Meten. Who is he? He is the Kagan, the Khan of Turk. He is the Roman Caesar. He is the Padishah. He is the two wali of the Masjidil Haram, Al-Aqsa and Mecca. He is the Amirul Mukminin, and he is the Khalifah. All these titles were now by him. He was beyond his grandfather Uthman and beyond his grandfather Bayezid II, even beyond his father Salim the First. Everybody knows him? Di sini ada nggak kira-kira yang punya bayangan siapakah dia? We know the movie, the Sulaiman Magnificent. Yeah? So this is Sulaiman the Magnificent. He was the one who perfected Islamism. He was the one who made the like Islamic state. He was the one who established the judges of Islam, and etc. Yeah. He was even recognized as Wali because he wrote Sufi's poem under the pen name of Muhibi. Oh, kita membaca puisi-puisi Muhibi itu begitu seolah-olah dia sangat sufi gitu kan. Sulaiman ibn Salim was born in 6 November 1494. He was crowned as Sultan on September 13, 1520, and he was died. He was passed away in 6 September 1566. You see the number? The number 666. His name Sulaiman reminds us to the name of Prophet Solomon, son of King David, and Prophet David. The king who brought Israel in his age. Yeah. During Solomon, Prophet Solomon, Israel was in his age. And everyone needs yearn for that era, for the era of Sulaiman ibn Daud. This was also happened to Sulaiman the Ottoman, yeah. As the final Tohbet tonight, I want to tell you all about the text in this Revelation 13, verse 11 until 17, that Ottoman was the one who erected the idol from Umayyad, who spoke about Islam, who spoke about the Quran, and he acted like the Umayyad, and then he also consumed every product of the Abbasids, and This product was developed into the idol. And the idol is called the pseudo-Islam, and the rite is neo-Islam, right? The ritual is neo-Islam. Why we call Sulaiman as not just because the numbers, but also everybody in the world today, not just Islam, but also other religions, also the secular, everyone is already influenced by the political and military policies that had been done during Sulaiman, but during Ottoman, during Sulaiman, yeah. Everybody was already influenced, impacted, and implicated by what he had been done during his rule, because he expand his kingdom, his caliph, far away to all Europe. Jadi pada masa Sulaiman Agung itu kita sudah melihat bagaimana Eropa berusaha dikuasai. Makanya Sulaiman Agung itu sampai sekarang itu sangat mempengaruhi ingatan sejarah dunia. Sehingga sebetulnya politik dan militer kita saat ini, dunia saat ini ada pengaruh. Entah itu trauma, entah itu karena relasinya dengan Ottoman. Makanya itu bukan hanya karena nomornya itu. Tadi ya hanya 6666. Tapi memang itu seperti yang ini disampaikan oleh The Black Pekan. Bilangan nomor itu adalah tanda yang ada pada masa pemerintahan Sulaiman Agung. So, Monster 666 is actually the rules during Sulaiman the Magnificent. And perhaps it includes actually Hürrem. Jadi bukan hanya Sulaiman, karena yang sangat berpengaruh pada masa itu kan si Hürrem itu juga kan. Nah, menarik ya. So this is my last talk. My last talk on our sohbet, Allah bir Muhammad Ali. Tidak masuk. Jadi itu yang terakhir saya bisa sampaikan. Kita bisa ke diskusi sekali lagi. Jadi itu 66 itu bukan nomor-nomor yang aneh, tapi waktu dulu saya belajar juga saya merasa wah ternyata 66 itu Sulaiman itu atau pemerintahannya termasuk Hürrem. Pada pernah nonton film itu kan ya, film Sulaiman the Magnificent itu ya. Hürrem. Ya?
Nonton.
Ya, ada pertanyaan?
Saya mau bertanya lagi, Mbak Gayatri.
Ya, monggo.
Itu tentang apa namanya? Mengapa Safafiyah itu menjadi istilahnya seteruannya Utsmaniyah? Sebenarnya pemicunya apakah karena aliran antara Syiah 12 dan Sunni itu, karena sebelumnya kan tanah Persia itu kan tadi seperti paparan adalah Islam yang bermazhab apa tadi Hanafiyah ya. Nah itu dan penyebabnya apa, dan itu kayaknya sampai sekarang seteruannya.
Iya, betul sekali ya.
Terima kasih.
Jadi bisa disampaikan ini agak rumit, mungkin agak kompleks. Sebetulnya itu bukan satu-satunya faktor bahwa karena Safawiyah dan ini, maka Safawiyah ini menjadi kompetitor bagi, kayaknya ada suara apa ya itu?
Suara ngorok.
Siapa yang tidur? Maaf ya, saya kaget, saya kira ada suara apa itu. Mungkin di mute dulu siapapun yang bersuara itu. Jadi sampai mana? Oh ya, sampai Safawiyah. Safawiyah itu kan sebetulnya muncul dari tarekat-tarekat yang biasa juga memberontak kepada pemerintah-pemerintah yang ada pada masa itu. Jadi memang karakter dari si AA itu sebetulnya adalah seperti yang saya sampaikan tadi, ya, si AA yang saya maksud adalah yang menerima dan mengakui otoritas Imam Ali sebagai imam. Jadi karakternya itu selalu apa ya, pembangkang gitu, karena dia lebih mengutamakan bagaimana kita mendapatkan keadilan, bagaimana rakyat itu sejahtera. Jadi kalau ada sesuatu kejadian di dalam masyarakat seperti ketidakadilan, penindasan, maka seorang syekh itu biasanya akan melakukan perlawanan, apapun bentuk perlawanannya. Nah, Safaviyah ini kemudian sampai pada puncak ketika pada awal-awal Ottoman itu berdiri, juga terjadi banyak ketidakadilan, baik yang dilakukan oleh Ottoman maupun yang dilakukan oleh Bizantin, walaupun pada saat itu Bizantin sudah mulai menurun. Karena itu kemudian mereka berhasil, bagaimana caranya mereka berhasil akhirnya untuk bersatu dan mendirikan dinasti Safaviyah. Ya. Jadi memang ada faktor dari ideologi si AA itu, karena ideologi kan tidak hanya pasifis Abel, tapi juga set. Kalau perlu punya amunisi, kita melawan. Kalau enggak, ya kita takiyah gitu kan. Nah, saat mereka sudah mengumpulkan kekuatan, mereka melawan. Ya, akan jadilah Safaviyah. Sebelum Safaviyah itu ada Babai. Babaiyah inilah tarekat yang diikuti oleh sebetulnya oleh Haji Bekaswali. Jadi Haji Bekaswali itu punya dua sanad, Babaiyah dengan Yasawiyah. Yasawiyah itu yang founder sendiri dari Naksabandiyah. Jadi dia punya dua sanad itu. Kemudian Babaiyah kemudian dilanjutkan oleh Safaviyah dan kawan-kawan. Jadi di sini ada hubungannya dengan pada masa itu, soalnya banyak ketidakadilan dan banyak terjadi itu tadi. Masa eranya boros, perang. Kayak zaman koboi lah, zaman kaos gitu lah, perang-perang dulu. Gitu. Semua orang saling berebut tempat, saling berebut di Anatolia, Eropa, dan lain-lain. Pokoknya sepertinya tidak ada kedamaian gitu kan. Nah, itu dia. Jadi itu yang terjadi pada masa itu. Ya, jadi intinya adalah ada faktor itu, tapi juga karena ada faktor juga tidak menginginkan ada satu-satu kekuatan namanya Ottoman itu. Ottoman itu kan Turk ya. Safaviyah ini cenderung bukan orang-orang Turk, dia banyak orang Persia juga. Di sini campur aduk aja masa suku, bukan hanya agama. Masa dia doang yang berkuasa gitu. Intinya seperti itu juga. Mungkin begitu yang bisa saya sampaikan untuk sementara, Mbak Wahyuni.
Ya, terima kasih, Mbak. Lantas, ada satu pertanyaan lagi. Di zaman Ottoman itu, ada tradisi fratricide, ya, yang menggorok adiknya sendiri yang supaya nggak naik tahta, gitu. Itu kira-kira karena apa?
Saya pikir itu karena tradisi tribal, ya, tradisi tribal Turki, bangsa Turk itu tribalnya sangat kuat, kesukuannya sangat kuat. Jadi di situ melatar belakangi ada ketakutan jika kalau saya yang naik takhta, kemudian saudara-saudara saya yang lain itu kalau saya tidak bunuh, mereka akan merebut takhta saya. Jadi di sini lebih kepada tribal. Ada warisan tribalisme mereka dulu, gitu, Mbak.
Oke, berarti itu warisan ya, istilahnya tradisi itu. Oke, ya. Terima kasih, Mbak.
Sama-sama. Iya. Jadi di filmnya Sulaiman itu yang selamat itu cuma adiknya itu doang ya, yang bungkuk itu kan siapa?
Jahangir ya.
Hah? Jahangir, ya Jahangir. Yang lain kan membunuh kan. Dan itu berakhir tradisi pratis itu ketika zaman Kosem gitu. itu juga serial terkenal. Jadi Kosem sama Hürrem itu dua perempuan yang sangat berkuasa di zaman Ottoman. Dan mereka latar belakangnya Kristen Ortodok. Oke, ada lagi mungkin? Kalau nggak ada, bisa kita tutup sekarang. Apa Mas Adi, nggak ada pertanyaan lagi? Mbak Rita kayaknya cukup. Mbak Rita tidur kayaknya.
Menyimak nih.
Mbak Rita tidur ya? Apa
ya, Mbak enggak, Rita, udah nggak tidur kok. Tadi tidur.
Tenang, Mbak. Untung kita di sini semua ini, apa namanya? Ngantuk ya. Herman, nggak ada pertanyaan?
Sedikit saya, sedikit.
Oh ya, siapa ya? Mbak, monggo, Mbak.
Man, ada yang belum saya pahami. Itu waktu zaman Ottoman itu berarti sudah tercerabut apa itu dari, ini sudah pisah ya sama Kristen itu ya, Seko. Islam ya, itu okay. Sudah berdiri sendiri. Yang
baik,
dari...
saya akan jawab itu. Jadi begini, pada masa Umayyah, yaitu pada zaman Abdul Malik, terutama di tangannya Al-Hajjaj, sebetulnya disitulah Islam sudah memisahkan diri dari Kristenan dan dari Yudaisme. Tapi ini pemahaman internal Muslim. Oke? Di luar itu, kalau kita mendengar atau membaca tulisan seperti apa? Damaskus apa? Yang ingat namanya, yang pasti ingat itu Agung itu apa namanya? Santo Damaskus siapa yang diulang?
Santo Yohanes Damaskus.
Ah, Santo Yohanes Damaskus. Santo Yohanes Damaskus itu menganggap bahwa Islam itu ada sempatan dari Yahudi atau tersesat dari kekristenan. Pemandangan ini sampai pada abad reformasi masih ada. Martin Luther masih menganggap misalnya Islam itu adalah sempalan dari Yahudi. Atau yang lain akan menganggap itu sempalan dari kekristenan karena memandang bahwa Yesus bukan Tuhan. Perlu dipahami bahwa kekristenan sebelum itu juga masih ada beragam. Jadi sampai abad 9 masih ada orang-orang Gnostik yang Aryan. Aryan itu tidak menganggap Yesus sebagai Tuhan. Ya kan? Jadi secara internal sudah terpisah sejak zaman Umayyah, tetapi secara eksternal sampai zaman Perang Salib, Islam itu dianggap sempalan, entah sempalannya Yahudi atau sempalannya Kristen. Baru setelah reformasi, Islam itu benar-benar dianggap sebagai benar-benar agama sendiri yang beda banget sama Kristen dan Yahudi. Bahkan sebetulnya reformasi itu lain. Maksudnya reformasi abad 16 itu ya, Martin Luther, Zwingli, Calvin. Yang namanya agama benar-benar taktik disebut sebagai tiga agama yang beda itu reformasi itu zamannya. Islam, Kristen, Yahudi. Sedangkan pada masa Ottoman, apa yang dibangun oleh Umayyah dan kemudian dikembangkan oleh Abbasiyah sebagai produk. Jadi, ibaratnya gini loh, Mbak. Kalau saya itu misalnya membuat jualan kue pada hari ini, kemudian anak saya bikin pabrik kuenya. Nah, jadi kuenya banyak gitu. Nah, setelah itu kemudian cucu saya itulah yang memapankan bahwa brand kue Gayatri adalah kue yang paling bonafit. Makanlah kue Gayatri. Nah, Ottoman melakukan itu. Dia udah dapat produknya dari Abbasiyah yang sudah jadi. Jadi dia tinggal mendirikan berhalanya. Kita menyembah dari apa yang dibangun oleh Ottoman. Tetapi pada masa Ottoman, sampai zamannya Sulaiman, Islam masih dianggap tempatan. Jadi zamannya Sulaiman itu sejaman ya sama reformasi, kan tadi abad 16. Reformasi itu kan sekitar zamannya Sulaiman juga. Dan sekitar zamannya Syekh Ismail. Jadi kita lihat ya, bagaimana dunia pada masa itu lagi bergolak gitu kan, lagi kekristenan berubah, kemudian Islam berubah. Terima kasih.
Iya, makasih saya kembali.
Iya, sama-sama. Kita ada lagi? Nggak ada?
Kosong, kosong.
Kosong. Mungkin bisa kita tutup? Kalau nggak ada lagi, boleh kita tutup?
Silakan.
Oke, tutup ya. Saya akan membacakan doa pada malam ini. Jadi yang ada di slide ya, mohon Agung untuk membuka slide-nya. Pada saat saya membacakan doa ini, segala permohonan yang ada di dalam hati kita untuk disampaikan. Dan saya juga ingin mendoakan semua yang sakit, semua yang bermasalah dalam kehidupan, pekerjaan, hutang-hutang, atau masalah ekonomi lainnya, dan masalah kejiwaan dan lainnya. Dan juga mari kita mendoakan saudara-saudara kita yang mengalami bencana alam, seperti yang baru terjadi di Cianjur, saat kita membacakan doa ini.
Tapi yang di Cianjur itu rasis banget Sepanduk gerejanya dicopoti semua Tadi ya. tadi muncul beritanya kayaknya nggak perlu deh itu.
Ya. Mari kita mulai doa kita pada malam ini. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Gusti, jika aku tidak memohon padamu, yang kemudian memberiku, kepada siapa lagi aku harus memohon yang kemudian memberiku. I beg your grace with all my heart, be merciful to me on part of your word. I have thought on my ways and turned my feet in your road. Gusti, jika aku tidak berdoa padamu, yang kemudian aku mengijabah doaku, kepada siapa lagi aku harus berdoa, yang kemudian memperkenankan doaku. Whom do I have in heaven but me? None upon earth I wish but me. But it's good for me to come near to Elohim. I set my dear to trust in the Lord Yahweh, so I may proclaim all your acts on high. Gusti, jika aku tidak merendahkan diri padamu, yang kemudian menyayangiku, kepada siapa lagi aku harus merendahkan diri, yang kemudian menyayangiku. Who remember us in our lowly estate for his mercy and use of efforts and years. Who gives in this his nourishment to all flesh for his mercy and use forever and ever. Gusti, sebagaimana engkau telah membelah lautan Islam Musa alaihissalam, dan kau selamatkan ia, aku memohon padamu. Sampaikan salawat kepada Muhammad dan ahlul bait Muhammad. Selamatkan kami dari apa yang kami takutkan. Dan bahagiakan kami dengan kebahagiaan yang segera dan tidak ditunda-tunda. Dengan karunia dan rahmatmu. Wahai yang maha pengasih dan segala pengasih. To him who divided the Red Sea in two for his mercy and rule forever. He is Yahweh, but offered to Pharaoh's army in Red Sea for his mercy forever at the mercy. Semoga Allah mendengar dan menyimak doa kita dan mengabulkan apa yang terbaik bagi kita. Semoga para musuh jahat, bijak agaib, membimbing pikiran dan tindakan kita, membaca apa kita di dalam hati, ulang yang terjadi. Amin. Banyak aktif masih di sana, tapi aku yang amin,
amin, amin,
amin, amin, amin, amin,
amin. Ya. Oke. Tadi yang video itu juga hati-hati. Siapa tahu itu provokasi.
Enggak, memang kenyataannya begitu kan. Yang pas waktu di Aceh juga sama begitu kan. Itu udah terjadi kan. Terus sekarang terjadi lagi. Memang begitu kenyataannya.
Tapi kalau melihat dari itunya sih, dari apa videonya, asal menurut saya itu pasti direkayasa ya. Soalnya aneh deh, liatin deh. Kan sekitarnya tuh